All right.
Oh, gosh. A Roman cross. Yeah, Jesus died on that. See, I don't care what you believe, just read history. It's a historical fact. So the question we have to ask is, what will you do with this man of misery? Only 6 hours on that wood, yet it completely changed history? But see, we've sold Jesus out. We've made a sacrifice foolery, like, oh, I'll just go to church on Easter and make his cross nice jewelry.
But the cross wasn't a symbol of faith, it was a symbol of death. I mean, imagine if someone wore an electric chair hanging around their neck. So what was different about that man on that day that could turn something that kills into something that saves? You see, he was unique because he was innocent. God actually became a man. Now that is different.
So on that cross, he says, I'm not dying because of me, I'm dying because of you. Not just for the sins that you have done, but for those that you will do. You see, on that cross, God treated Jesus like he was us. He poured out his wrath on the Son so that he might prove that he's just. He took all of your filth and all of your sin, and the beauty is that when you trust in Jesus, you're included in him.
But first, walk with me what it must have been like that night. When the Son of God looked like he lost the fight. No heartbeat, no breathing, no sign of life. Jesus tasted death, and it didn't feel right.
Have you let that sink in? That Jesus died? No, really, Jesus actually died.
3 days in the tomb, lifeless laid his remains. It looked like the king had given up his crown, like he had given up his reins. But on Sunday, something started to change. You heard a thump, thump. Blood started pumping in his veins, heart beating, blood pulsing. Satan felt his power break because the Son of God was dead, but now the Son of God was awake.
And every breath that he took was like a punch to Satan's face. The resurrection only proves that you're no longer in your sin. You are under grace.
So celebrate, because when Jesus went to the grave, you did too. And when he rose from the grave, your life became new. He said, my job is finished, let the new life begin. You can actually walk in freedom. Stop wallowing in your sin.
And because the chains have been broken and the stones have been rolled away, God doesn't love a future you. He loves you today.
You are clean. You are spotless, and the curse has been squashed. That's what baptism is. It's showing you've been washed. So rejoice with me that we aren't waiting for a verdict, because he's already said not guilty, and the resurrection proves he assured it.
Because our whole lives we feasted on sin and we couldn't pay the tab. Yet Jesus walks over to our bill and says, I'll take care of that. So stop trying to pay your own debt. In fact, God doesn't even expect it. See, the cross shows payment given. Resurrection shows payment accepted.
So walk in freedom because you are free. The resurrection is only a stamp that says it's a guarantee.
A royal decree proclaiming we're children of the King.
So even when your mouth can't, let your life always sing.
He's alive, 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 hallelujah, alive, praise and glory to the Lamb. He's alive, 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 hallelujah, alive forever, amen.
He is alive. The
It's a great day to celebrate. Won't you stand and join us as we sing together?
Let the children sing a song of liberation. The God of our salvation set us free. Death, where is thy sting? The curse of sin is broken. The empty tomb stands open. Come and see. He's alive, alive, alive. Hallelujah. Alive, praising glory to the Lamb. He's alive, alive, alive. Hallelujah. Alive forever. Amen. Let my heart sing out for Christ the one and only, so powerful and holy, rescue me. Death won't hurt me now because he has redeemed me. No grave will ever keep me from my King. He's alive, alive, alive. Hallelujah. Alive, praise and glory to the Lamb. He's alive, alive, alive. Hallelujah. Alive forever. Amen.
Worthy is the Lamb, worthy of our praise. Worthy is the one who has overcome the grave. Let the people dance, let the people sing.
Worthy is the mighty King.
Worthy is the Lamb, worthy of our praise. Worthy is the one who has overcome the grave. Let the people dance, let the people sing.
Worthy is the mighty King.
Worthy is the Lamb, worthy of our praise. Worthy is the one who has overcome the grave. Let the people dance, let the people sing.
Worthy is the mighty King.
Jesus foretells his death and resurrection in Mark 8:31 through 38. And beginning with 31, and he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. And he said this plainly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." And calling the crowd to him with his disciples, he said to them, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will be saved. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with his holy angels."
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count the cost. And
It's so good to see each of you here today. So I want to say welcome today. And who's alive today? Jesus Christ. He is risen. That ought to make us very happy. We come now to prayer time. And Brian has created these bulletins where you can write your prayer request. I encourage you that if you have any personal prayers today to write them on there and put them in the offering plate. We as leaders get together and or he lets us know about those prayer requests, and we do pray for you. Today, if you look in the bulletin, there are some people mentioned there. I'm going to just highlight one, the family of Marlene Williams. Not the Marlene that we have here, but the sister of Jan Epperson passed away this past week. And their funeral is tomorrow. John and Jan have been great as they've been involved here. And so let's just remember their family. Marvin Keller shared with me this morning that Louise Doty is overcoming pneumonia, but very weak. So remember Louise Doty in your prayers. Rainey spoke to me this morning and asked us to remember her ex-husband, Jim Stevens. Is in intensive care on a respirator, not doing very good. Please remember his son Thomas as well, as I'm sure he's taking it hard. So remember the Stevens, Jim Stevens, as he is in the hospital. And Marla Crawford shared with me she has family involved with the police department in Des Moines. And if maybe you may have heard the news yesterday, and two officers of the police department in Des Moines were killed in a head-on collision, as well as the prisoner they're hauling, as well as the man that ran into them. All these families, please remember them in your prayer. It's difficult to come at a time like this and have, on a day of rejoicing like this, to have this sadness. The joy of today is that yesterday was Friday, you might say, but today is Sunday. The Lord is risen. We have hope beyond death. God has created that through his son's sacrifice. And so at a time, one of the things that I'm reminded of is when Jesus went to the cross, we read about in Luke 23, the very first thing he said as he is being crucified, he wept over Jerusalem as he went to the cross. So there's a time of mourning for him personally. But one of the first words that came out of his mouth that we read about in Luke 23 is he says, "Forgive them, Father, for they don't know what they're doing," as the men placed him on that cross. And as he hung there and he died. With that, we have rejoicing today. And so I'm just going to ask you to give you a time to take your own prayers to God. I'm going to have a prayer of silence. Then I'm going to close in prayer. So please bow your head with me. Our gracious Heavenly Father, it's so good to be here in this house today, especially this day as we remember the great feat that you did. Your own son went to the cross and died on our behalf, but today he broke the bonds of death. Satan was defeated, scripture is fulfilled, and Christ was found alive, never to die again. And Lord, through him we have that chance of eternal life. We thank you for this, and we thank you that for everybody that's here. I just ask that you be with them and bless them this week, and pray that they'll take your name with them. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. We have a special joy this morning because of what Christ did for us on the cross. Lindsay Parker has come forward, and she wants to declare her acceptance of Christ as her Savior through the form of baptism. So we'll turn it over to Brian.
The resurrection for sure, but we also celebrate Lindsay coming and wanting to be baptized into Jesus Christ. You might remember a few weeks ago she mentioned that she had accepted the Lord and just had changed, and that was exciting for us to hear. But just in her study and in her obedience, she wants to be baptized into Jesus Christ today, and so we just rejoice with that. It's a great picture of what we celebrate today is as oftentimes the baptism is called a watery grave, and we wonder why. What's so great about that? Well, it's a burial and a resurrection. Just like Jesus was in the tomb and resurrected, baptism is a picture of exactly that, where we're putting the old Lindsay to death, and she's rising new, washed clean, her sins are gone. We aren't going to make her list all her sins in front of you today. She's already taken care of that, but baptism is just this this commitment and this new start, new life. And so, Lindsay, we're proud of you, and we're excited to do this. I'm joined today by Thomas. Thomas is really the one that introduced Lindsay to the Lord and brought her to this point, and he wants to share a few words with you as well.
As I'm standing here this morning, there's so many things that, you know, I can say and talk about and everything. And on the way here, there was a few things that I was like, oh, I got to mention this and this and this. But I think the main thing that I want to make sure that we share is this world is falling apart. We know that as Christians. We can see that even as non-Christians. We know that there are so many turmoils, so many tragedies in life that come to us, all of a sudden impact. Lives can be changed in a split second. And as Christians, we need to do our due diligence and make sure that we are representing Christ in the manner that we need to be representing Him in. I stand here not perfect at all. I've made several mistakes, but I know that for a fact that Christ is the one who has set me free. He has redeemed me. He's the one that's standing beside me, and He's the one that's given me new hope and new life. And if I can give that to somebody else, and if you can give that to somebody else, then we are doing exactly what we are called to do. Salvation doesn't fix our problems, but it equips us to be able to face our problems. And that's one thing that I want to make sure that I instill in Lindsay's life or anyone else's life that I come in contact with. It's a daily affirmation that we choose to walk with God, that we choose to have God join us, and we choose to live by His choices, live by the actions that He wants us to live by, the words that He wants us to say. And it's so important, it's so hard to do, but it is so important to daily sacrifice ourselves to edify Him. Scripture that I want to leave with Lindsay today and leave with you guys as well is Isaiah 46:4, where Isaiah is telling us that God is the same. Actually, God is the one saying it. He is, I am the same. I will be the same for you in your old age. I will be the same. I will be the one to raise you up. I will be the one to bear your burdens. I will be the one to walk with you. I'll be the one to guide you and sustain you and to rescue you. And so it's been an honor and a privilege to be able to share Christ with Lindsay and to be able to see her grow and just take those daily struggles and lay them at Christ's feet. So that's why I'm glad to be here today.
Amen. Thanks, Thomas. Lindsay, we want you just to share a little bit of your faith with everybody. I want to ask you an important question, a question that many here today have answered. And do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and do you accept Him as your Lord and as your Savior?
Yes,
I do. That's exciting to hear. Because of your desire to be, because your desire to share that faith and it's an affirmative response to Jesus being your Lord, we're going to baptize you for forgiveness of sins in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit.
All we know is
resurrection. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and he's coming back.
We just want to say thanks for joining us today. We appreciate you coming out on Easter and being a part of the service here at Madison and worshiping with us and singing with us, get to witness Lindsay's celebration. So thanks for joining us on this great day for those of us who follow Jesus. It was during Operation Desert Storm, dating myself a little bit, I remember that. Some of our young folks don't remember that, but it was a important time in our church history, and a soldier, young man, got a Dear John letter. Others around him were getting love letters and wonderful things from their girlfriends and wives, and he gets a Dear John letter, and she says, it's over. So here he is, fighting a war overseas, gets the bad news, and he's down and depressed. It's over. To make matters worse, she informs him that not only is it over, she's engaged now and she's going to be married. And so on top of that, she says, you know that one picture, my favorite picture that I gave you? I'd like that back. We want to share that during the wedding. That's going to be part of our pictures that day. I mean, this young man's devastated, you know. Long ways from home, doesn't know what to do. He's heartbroken. His girlfriend was now marrying somebody else. And on top of that, their favorite picture, she wants it back. A buddy found out what was going on, and he kind of rallied to encourage this young soldier, and they come up with a plan, and from every corner of the camp, soldiers handed over extra photos of their girlfriends and said, let's have some fun with this. So they collected several hundred pictures of girlfriends. He put them in a shoebox. He said, please find your picture. But make sure you return the rest. For the life of me, I can't remember which one you were. Different perspectives on events. I'm sure life was different for both of them. Different perspectives. Have you ever had a change in perspective where you looked at something one way, and then through a survey of events, later on you looked at it and it was completely different, a change of perspective? Maybe you've done that. We love the outdoors. We love to canoe, and we've taken groups down to the Royal Gorge in Colorado, and it's 1,500-foot cliffs, and you're at the top of this beautiful mesa, and then this thing, and you're looking down at this tiny little river, and you go, this is nothing. We can do this, and this little river's down there, and it looks like a nice meandering river, but then you get down there, and there's white water, and you're splashing and going through the big waves, and it looks completely different at the bottom than the top. It's a different perspective. I always laugh, and I was probably one of them, a perspective on parenting. Before you had kids, you could look at other parents, and you'd see them at Walmart, and they'd be having trouble, and you go, I'm never going to parent like that. My kid's never going to eat any of that kind of stuff. I mean, they're going to eat vegetables all the time. They're never going to act out in public. And then when you have kids, your perspective changes a little bit. And all of a sudden, you see it from a different lens, a different vantage point. Easter offers different perspectives. For many, Easter is about a big chocolate bunny or a fluffy bunny, and you take a picture with it at the store, kind of similar to Santa Claus. That's one perspective of Easter. For others, Easter is the perspective of a different animal, a little lamb. I saw somewhere that says, when talking about animals, it says, in the political situation, if you don't like the donkey, if you don't like the elephant, try the lamb. Today we're going to be talking about the Lamb of God. Different perspectives. When Jesus walked the earth, lambs, little sheep, were an important part of the spiritual life of his people, of Israel. They were common, and we talked about that a couple weeks ago. We talked about us being sheep and him being the good shepherd. For centuries, long, long time, sheep had been sacrificed. That doesn't mean much to us, but that was a common occurrence. I mean, sheep had been sacrificed. In the temple, two lambs died every day, 9 o'clock and 3 o'clock, for the sins of the nation. They were killed. They were slaughtered. When they died, the priest would blow what is called a shofar, a ram's horn, and the people within earshot would know that a sacrifice has been made, and they probably went about their business. A sacrifice marked by blood. To sacrifice here meant to slit its throat. That's what happened. These little lambs would be cut open from the throat, and the blood would be spilt, and a sacrifice would be made for the sins of the people. But on top of just those daily sacrifices, there were other Jewish holidays where lambs were sacrificed as well. This had been going on for years, for years. I mean, this was just a part of their culture, a part of their experience. I got to thinking as I prepared, I wonder how many thousands of sheep and lamb had their throats slit. I wonder. I mean, thousands of sheep through the years, this was what they did. This is, you know, today the animal rights sacrifice groups, PETA or whatever, they'd be coming unglued if that happened. I wonder if this just became commonplace, just a normal routine happening for the people of that day and age. Ho-hum, maybe, just going through the motions. No one even noticed the shofar blowing anymore. They just went about their business, and it was probably fast-paced, and they paid no attention because they heard it every day. They noticed every day, and these sheep were being slaughtered. I can remember in my college years, I served at a church in Prescott, Arizona, right? We were part of a church camp, United Christian Youth Camp, and I heard the stories of a youth pastor who did exactly what we're talking about today. They took a little sheep, and in front of the whole camp at the campfire devotions, they took a knife, and they drained the blood of the sheep right in front of everybody. I'm glad I wasn't that youth pastor. I think there was trouble to be had. But on Passover, it was a little bit different. Passover was special. It was the day. It was the big happening, the day of things going on. This was the day that connected God and his people in a special way, and it required a blood sacrifice. And the sacrifice was for sins to be forgiven. They had sins, and these sheep would be slaughtered, and their sacrifices would make good. They would make good by these sheep. It had been going on. You know, you probably remember the sacrifice. They were released from bondage. God's people, Israel, they'd been in bondage, the Egyptians, 400 years, and Moses comes back to lead the people out, and he says, let my people go. Most of us are familiar with that in some form or another. And he goes and he says, let my people go. And says, okay. And they don't. And they send plagues. And there's the pestilence comes. The grasshoppers comes. All the rivers turned, all the water turned to blood. I mean, there were some miraculous things going on, but they would never release the people. This had been 400 years. These were valuable people to the Egyptians. They made buildings. They were slave labor. And he didn't want to let them go until the last one. You'll remember, they had to put blood on the doorposts. They would come, and on the doorposts, they would paint blood, they were told. And if you had blood on the doorpost, the angel of death would pass over that household, and they would be spared. If they didn't, the firstborn male in each family, an animal, they would die. And that's exactly what happened. If they didn't put the blood of the lamb on the doorpost, there was death. And so the blood saved them. And that's what this Passover event was celebrated for. It was a celebration that led them out of slavery, and finally Pharaoh says, okay, go. And they go, and just an amazing story of God's people, and it's an amazing story. So here we are years later. They were celebrating this Passover event. Families would get together, and they would gather. It'd be thousands of people in here celebrating. And they knew that everybody had to get a lamb. You had to go out and put to the shepherds and buy a sheep, and you were supposed to, they had specifics, supposed to be the best they had without blemish. Yeah, there were regulations. So they get this lamb. They were in town. They didn't have a place, so they had to keep that lamb with them. I imagine this lamb became a pet in some ways. They had to feed the lamb. They had to pet the lamb. They had to take care of the lamb. And you know, if you've ever had kids and pets, that can be a challenge. But they probably developed a little bit of a relationship with this lamb, I'm guessing. And so you can imagine what Passover was like when it was time for the sacrifice. As young boys and girls had to watch this lamb being sacrificed, probably a little confusing, for the forgiveness of their sins. And I imagine there was, I had two boys. I didn't have girls. I can imagine the drama of going, okay, time, we'll slit the throat, we'll drain the blood, and the girls are just looking on in horror, you know, let alone little boys, okay? And so there's this relationship that happened, and I'm sure there was questions, Dad, why did we have to kill Fluffy? Okay, why did Fluffy have to die? That's the sacrifice God requires for our sins. Because I lied to my mom? Yeah. Because of this? And so there was this relationship with this lamb and sin, and they knew that lamb had done nothing wrong. They knew that lamb was innocent. But that lamb had to take the sacrifice, had to shed his blood for those children and for those adults, and moms and dads. And that had been going on for years and years. I imagine it was interesting. But Passover was a special celebration. I remember getting a pet. Well, I was little. We lived in Griswold, Iowa, so it was before I was 6 years old. And I can remember, I think it came from Grandpa and Grandma Chitwood, and it was a little bunny for Easter. I think it was pastel green in color. I think they dyed it or something like that. And anyway, we killed it somehow the next day. I mean, we handled it too much or something. So this little bunny died, you know. We were devastated, and there was no resurrection that Easter on that little bunny. And, you know, it kind of dawned on me, we've really never talked that through as a family before, what exactly happened with that little bunny. But anyway, I just share that to say, death can be dramatic. It had to be for those families as these little innocent lambs shed its blood. I think what made the Passover so different from those daily sacrifices, unlike the ones at the temple, the lambs were slain, the shofar blew, but there was no relationship there. There was nothing special. They could just go about their business. They didn't have to witness this death. They just knew it happened, and they kind of went about their business. But for the Passover, they had to kind of witness this death. So I think it meant something at Passover to see that this lamb had been sacrificed for the sins of that family and for those people. It had to be something. So interesting how God works. Jesus died and was sacrificed during Passover. Coincidence? I don't think so. It was purposeful. Our God is so great. He had a plan. He knew this picture would just paint itself out beautifully. I don't think there's ever been a better object lesson in the history of mankind than this Passover event and Jesus dying on the cross. I mean, it is just a perfect symbolism. It was foretold years before. It shouldn't have been a surprise. People should have sort of got it. We have a perspective different from their perspective because we have years and we have God's word and all those things. So we sort of get how all the pieces of the puzzle fit together, but they didn't. Isaiah talked about it in Isaiah 53. John the Baptist talked about it. John 1:29 says this, "The next day he saw Jesus coming toward him. He said, 'Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world.'" Behold, the Lamb of God. This was God's lamb. People understood that. Sheep was a part of the culture. They sort of got it, but they sort of didn't get it. After the resurrection, though, people started seeing things from a different perspective, a different lens. Peter called Jesus lamb in his first letter. Paul called Jesus the Passover lamb. John referred to Jesus as the lamb 28 times in 18 chapters. And so they had a different perspective after the resurrection than before. They called him the Lamb of God, even though they referred to him a little bit before that. And when they call him the Lamb of God, they're calling him the perfect, unblemished sacrifice for the sins of the people. The scripture we're going to look at today, it's really short. It's in your bulletins. It's found in a letter that Paul wrote to the church in Corinth. 1 Corinthians 5, the last part of verse 7. And I struggled using it because it's really not an Easter passage. I mean, it really isn't. But it just became a part of what they were talking about. 1 Corinthians 5, 7. And really he's talking about they had some sin in the church there, and he said, you need to clean the sin up and move on, you know. And so he writes this. It's the last part of verse 7. It says, cleanse out the old leaven that you may be a new lump as you really are unleavened. For Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed. This isn't some big teaching on what Jesus did. This isn't some discord. It was just normal everyday talking. He says, Jesus, our lamb, has been sacrificed. The price for sin has been paid. This was just him kind of somewhat casually just going through, hey, don't you know? Jesus was our Passover lamb. The price of sin has been paid. Don't continue in your sin. The sacrifice has been made. It's really not an Easter passage, but I just like it because it just like us talking. I mean, just as we talk. It wasn't this big sermon. It wasn't this big discourse. It was just, don't you know? The lamb has been sacrificed. We understand a little bit about the culture of that time with sheep and all, but we really don't know. But we know right now. And let's fast forward a little bit to the end of the New Testament, Revelation 5:13. And it says this, and I heard every creature in heaven, on earth, and under the earth, and in the sea, and all that is in them, saying, to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and amen. So we fast forward to the death of the Lamb. Now we're going to the future where Jesus sits on his throne. He's still called the Lamb of God. We understand that a little bit. How can that be, though, if a sacrifice has been made? How can we go to the future unless there's been a resurrection? We celebrate a resurrection today. I don't know why. Sometimes I think we would have certainly done things different than God. Why the Middle East? Why back then? Why not wait a few years and come to America where it's big and strong and powerful and the world kind of looks at us? But that's sort of what one writer said Israel was the perfect time and the perfect place for God to orchestrate this event. It was the perfect time and place. It was situated perfect geographically. People were coming in for the Passover. It was perfect. There were safe roads finally at this point in time. Language wasn't an issue this time. People were traveling easier. It was a perfect place, one writer said. One writer said Israel was the most visible, accessible place in the entire world. At the very time, the world was finally prepared for a vast dissemination of the most important story ever told. So God had this planned, this beautiful picture. During Passover, Jesus crucified. Some go as far to say 9 o'clock and 3 o'clock were significant. The ram's horn. It's just a beautiful picture that God orchestrated here of a sacrifice. His people understood what was going on. The message of that story is that God loves us, me, you, his people. And it was so great he sent his son to die that whoever believes in him should have everlasting life. We're familiar with that passage. That's about love, a love that he has for his people. No longer are sheep sacrificed for the sins of the people. That put an end to it. God sent his son to be our sacrifice for our sins. Lambs had been dying for years, thousands of them, as substitutes for sin. Just to prepare the way, God had prepared this until this coming event we call Easter, a resurrection. That's how he communicated his love for his people. A sacrifice was made. You don't have to go through all that anymore for your sins. He has met the demands that God had put forth. How much did he love us? Romans 5:8. But God showed his love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. While we were yet sinners, there was an innocent man, and his blood was shed, just like an innocent lamb had to take the sins of the people. Interesting. why we were yet sinners. Christ didn't die just for godly people, just for the people who go to church all the time. He died for the godly and ungodly. Why we were yet sinners. Not too many people I know would die for ungodly. A few would sacrifice their lives maybe for godly people. But God shows no partiality. He died for the sins of the world. Had those ancient families have lived sin-free, they wouldn't have had to sacrifice a lamb. Similar to us. If we were able to live sin-free, a sacrifice wouldn't have had to be made. But we have sin. And God provided a way out of that sin, a relationship made because he loved his people. Sin has a pretty high price tag. And really, sometimes it gets pretty personal. I don't know if you remember the movie. I can't even remember what year it came out. The Passion of the Christ. Pretty hard to forget that. Remember the visual imagery? We've been watching something in our small group Sunday school class. And just the visual agony and the suffering and what Jesus endured. And he did nothing wrong. But he did it for my sin and for your sin. And so it gets very personal. Just like I think those families had to struggle with cutting the lamb's throat, it probably got personal. Why would this innocent lamb have to be slain? And when I see those images of Jesus and what he went through and the beatings and the floggings and the crown of thorns and the scorn and the ridicule that I'm partially responsible for, I contributed to that. It wasn't just some event 2,000 years ago. My sins, he took my sins to the cross. My evil thoughts that I have, maybe the gossiping tongue that I might have, my lustful thoughts that I might have occasionally, my selfish behavior at times. He took my sins. He took your sins. And he did away with them at the cross. It gets very personal. He took it for me. He endured a sham trial. He was convicted by a Roman ruler, carried away by a mob-type atmosphere, humiliated by a crown of thorns, laughed at, mocked at, ridiculed, spit on, beaten and flogged with a cat of nine tails, endured so much for the sin of Brian and for your sin as well. But the resurrection changed all that. Never again would a lamb have to be slain for the people. The Lamb of God had died, and it was finished, as he proclaimed. But we know the tomb was empty on Sunday morning. Scripture tells us, Matthew 28, when daylight came, the earth shook, the stone moved away from the entrance of the tomb, the soldiers fell down as if they were dead, the angels awaited for the believers to come. Wouldn't it have been cool to have been one of the angels? It's like, can't wait! I can't wait to share the story! Here they come. I see them coming. How are we going to get tell the good news? And the women come up to the tomb, and they're just like, I can't wait to see their faces when we tell them, why are you here looking for the living among the dead? He is risen. That would have been a fun job to celebrate. What a cool job that angel had. I'll take that assignment. I'll share the good news with them. These women were devastated. And now they hear the good news that Jesus was risen. And they do what everyone else would do. They celebrate and they worship. They spread the good news. Imagine the look on their faces was incredible. Sorrow turned to joy. Mary's tears from a broken heart turned to a celebration because of her resurrection. Soon the disciples would be different because of her resurrection. Interesting to me, and I thought about sharing evidences why we believe Jesus is the Christ. It takes a lot of faith, really, to believe that Jesus rose from the dead. I get that. We struggle with that at times. We could list lots of evidences. We can't prove that this happened other than our lifestyles prove it. But there's so many hard evidence. If you come as a skeptic, they go, and I don't believe it. I can give you evidences. You've probably made up your mind just like I've made up my mind in my faith. And I could point to the fact that right after this, Christianity grew and blossomed. Why would it happen if it was a lie? Why would Christianity grow so fast? Why would his 12 disciples, who were once filled with fear the week before, they ran, they didn't want to be seen with Jesus, why now were they bold in their faith? Why did that lead them to a life where most of them all but one, I think, suffered an amazing, painful death for the sake of Christ. They were martyred. Would they have done that for a lie? I don't think so. I don't think they would have said, guys, we've sort of invested 3 years with this guy. He's dead, but let's just fake it. Let's just kind of go on and live life like he's still alive, and we'll just kind of go through the motions. No, they had witnessed a resurrection that led them to a life that says, we got to devote our lives to this. They saw something. That resurrection changed everything. What about James, the brother of Jesus, who had never said, had never recognized his brother as the Messiah before? He was probably jealous of him, first of all. But after the resurrection, Jesus' brother, becomes a believer. There's an empty tomb. There's lots of evidences that say, you know what, I think this really did happen. I'm not here to convince you of that. I just challenge you to think through that in your own way. Maybe a different perspective can change the results. But because of the resurrection, we get eternal life. Remember the passage we used as our short text today? Paul called for a major change, overcome sin, because the Lamb had been slain. Behavior changes because of the resurrection. The resurrection changes everything for us, changes our life, it changes every aspect of life. Ran across this story. I don't know if it's true or not, but it does illustrate the point we're trying to make. World War I, someone overheard in a bunker in a foxhole, a man had been injured, and he was with his buddy, and it was obvious this young soldier was going to die. And he knew he only had minutes to live at the most, and he calls his buddy over and he said, I know you've had a tough life. I know that you're even wanted back home. I know you've done evil, and you've got a terrible reputation, and you've got really nothing to live for. As soon as you get back home, you'll probably have to be put in jail, and I know there's a warrant out for you. The dying man pulls down his buddy and he says, I got a deal for you. He takes off his dog tags, takes his ID and all that, and he says, here, I'm about done. My life's done. I'm good to go. You can have a brand new start. You don't have to be burdened by your past reputation. You can start with a new identity. What would you do in that instance if you were that man? He says, here's my papers, here's my ID, here's my dog tags. You can assume my identity. And your past no longer has to affect your future. Why would anyone refuse that offer? I suppose there's logistics. They either love sin or they have a great deal of pride. And I think that's what stops a lot from changing their perspective on Easter. They either love their sin so much they just want to live in it, or they're too prideful to say, I'm not going to believe in that. I don't know if that's your story or not, but it's easy to fall into that category where we just love the lifestyle we live, even if it's sinful, and sometimes we're too prideful to admit we've blown it and we haven't lived up to it. There's plenty of good evidence of a resurrection, but we have to be like children and accept it on faith. Jesus offers the same thing that little story illustrates. Life change. We don't have to be burdened by our past. We can start new. Isn't that the joy of Easter? A new life, a new beginning. We witnessed Lindsay get that new start earlier today. Men are going to come down and to the front. We're going to have a prayer in just a moment. We're going to invite you to participate in communion. Communion is a special time to us here at Madison. We celebrate it every week because it takes us back to this celebration. It takes us back to a resurrection. And each week we celebrate. And I suppose we could be like the temple people who, it could get old, and if we aren't careful, it could be just like the shofar blowing, like we just go about our normal business. But we try hard to make the communion a special time as we focus on the cross. And we know the sin that's been in our life, either past or present, and we deal with it. And the cross, this is a beautiful time for us to deal with that sin. So you're invited today. Sometimes this can be a little awkward if you don't go to church often. Do I take communion? Do I not take communion? We invite you. If you understand what Jesus did for you on the cross and what that means for you, we invite you to participate. If you choose not to, we don't look down. We don't do that. This is just a special time that we want you to invite you to take part of the communion if you understand what Jesus did for you. But don't if you don't feel like it, you won't offend us by passing it on. So just make yourself comfortable with that. Just want to close, and then we'll have our prayer for our communion. Read a passage from 1 Peter chapter 1. Knowing that you are ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your fathers, not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ. You were bought with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. He was foreknown before the foundation of the world, but was made manifest in the last times for the sake of you, who through him are believers in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him the glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. One man interprets it like this. Your life is a journey you must travel with deep consciousness of God. It cost God plenty to get you out of that dead-end, empty-headed life you grew up in. He paid with Christ's sacred blood, you know. He died like an unblemished sacrificial lamb. And this was no afterthought. Even though it was only lately, at the end of the ages, become public knowledge, God always knew he was going to do this for you. It's because of this sacrificed Messiah, whom God then raised from the dead and glorified, that you trust God, that you know that you have a future in God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're grateful today for the resurrection. Thankful that you took our sins, our evil thoughts, our poor relationships, the poor choices we've made, the sin that of selfishness, or whatever is represented by so many different people here today, including myself. We're thankful that that perfect lamb took my sin, took our sin to the cross with him that day. And so now we just acknowledge that we were helpless before you. You had a plan all along to bring your son Jesus Christ to this point. Thank you for the power of the resurrection that gives us hope for a future. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Father, we thank you for how you watch over us and take care of our needs. Pray that we're willing to get back to you today. Thank you for the message that we heard. May we respond to it. May others see in us that you are alive. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him. Final breath he gave, as heaven looked away, the Son of God was laid in darkness. A battle in the grave, the war on death was waged, the power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake, the stone was rolled away. His perfect love could not be overcome. Now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Forever he is glorified. Forever he is lifted
He is alive. We serve a risen Savior. We're grateful that you've come to celebrate with us today. Maybe you have questions about what we've talked about today. We're privileged that you came, and so we'd love to talk to you sometime. You're welcome to come back any Sunday. Perspectives. Sometimes our perspectives change, and we don't know quite when or how. I was reminded earlier today of a perspective that was changed about Easter. Jesus wasn't the only one crucified that day. There were two thieves on a cross right next to him, one on the right and the left. Maybe you're familiar with the story, maybe you're not. But there was a perspective changed by one of the thieves that day. So he looked at Jesus even in his death, in his final moments. And I think he swallowed his pride. One was still making fun of him and said, if you're the Messiah, you know, all this conversation, go on and laugh at him, Jesus. The other one sort of humbles him and says, hey, Jesus, remember me. A different perspective. He'd seen what he'd seen. He'd witnessed. He said, this man was truly the Son of God. One of the Roman soldiers even said that. So this one thief on the cross next to him had a different perspective. We don't know what kind of life he lived. But obviously he was convicted and he was put on a cross and crucified. He had some issues. And what was the worst day of his life became his best day. Because Jesus says, today you will be with me in paradise. Perspectives changed. That can be your experience as well. Let's stand and swing. Again, thanks for being our guest today. We wish you a blessed Easter. Let's pray and we'll sing. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for this Lamb of God. And thank you for that picture that you had planned so long ago, and you painted out this word picture in front of the whole world to see that now we don't need a little sheep. You've provided the Lamb who took away the sins of the world. For that, we're grateful, thankful that you are alive. We praise you for that. In Jesus' name we pray.
Worthy is the Lamb, worthy of our praise. Worthy is the one who has overcome the grave. Let the people dance, let the people sing. Worthy is the mighty King. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy of our praise. Worthy is the one who has overcome.